Well, you were hard-pressed to find a UFC fighter, past or present, who was picking Conor McGregor to beat Nathan Diaz on Saturday night. It seemed like the pre-fight was owned by Diaz, at least according to a lot of people. You saw a very emotional Conor McGregor in the days leading up to the fight, spilled over at the press conference, at the weigh-in. Even a guy like Brian Stann was waffling on it and eventually sided with Nate Diaz. Kenny Florian, one of the few guys who stuck with Conor McGregor from the beginning, and you had to like what you saw, man. Just a masterful performance, the adjustments, the execution, the heart, and everything else, and I think you and I are in agreement that he deserved to win the fight, and we'll start there.
He absolutely did, man. And you know what? Conor didn't just have to deal with Nate Diaz. He was fighting a few things here. Obviously, fighting the pressure of having to come off the most devastating loss of his career, the most high-profile loss of his career. There was a lot of pressure on him, you know, coming off this whole UFC 200 debacle. Fighting a man at 170 pounds, Nate Diaz probably was, you know, at least 185 pounds on fight night. I mean, there was just so much that he had to tackle here, and he responded extremely well. His ability to slip punches and return with that left hand, it's one of the most potent weapons in the game right now. Just looked masterful. And how many different strikes he threw with his upper body. I mean, the punches to the body, the punches to the head, slipping left and landing in the left, slipping right and landing with the left hand, landing that right hook repeatedly. I mean, the guy was on fire. It was really a masterful performance. Nate Diaz is as tough as they fucking come, okay?
Toughest fighter on the roster. It's gotta be.
It's unbelievable. I mean, the damage that he took, he couldn't see in a couple rounds, and he continues to press forward, continues to look for a way to win. I mean, it was just such an insane fight. Now, for anyone who had it for Nate Diaz, you're crazy. I mean, that's just as simple as that. Round two, some people had round two for Diaz. How do they have, in what bizarro world do you have a guy who wins a round, who gets knocked down twice in the fight and loses 3 minutes and 30 seconds of the round and didn't knock down the other guy once?
Right.
You can't score it for Diaz, unfortunately. I mean, I know you guys are hardcore fans, and that's a lot of it, John. I feel like heading into this fight, people hated Conor McGregor so much that they didn't want to hear about Conor winning. They thought Nate was going to win. Their minds were completely skewed over to Nate Diaz's side. And is Nate Diaz a fantastic fighter? Absolutely. Is he a tough style matchup for Conor McGregor? Absolutely. But Conor did win that fight. You know, I was talking to TJ over here earlier about round three. He thought it should have been a 10-8 round for Nate. I didn't see it as a 10-8 round. I thought it was close enough throughout. At the end, I thought Nate finished extremely strong, and Conor was absolutely hurt in that fight. But in that round, I didn't think it was a 10-8, like one of the judges called it.
Right.
You know, it had it a draw. But just a fantastic fight. And TJ tweeted something earlier that there was no loser, and I absolutely agree with that as well.
And, you know, I'm okay with judges being liberal with a 10-8 there in round three relative to some other rounds, but I had it the way you did, rounds one, two, and four for Conor McGregor. And the fourth round, I think, is going to be the story of this fight and what people are talking about months from now. Some people are suggesting this is the single best round that Conor McGregor has ever fought in the UFC, and to do it on the heels of what happened in round three is just sort of superhuman, you know, for someone like me sitting home on my couch. A lot of the criticism coming from people who believe that Nate Diaz won this fight was about Conor McGregor sort of resetting, walking away, borderline turning his back a little bit as possible grounds for timidity, which it most certainly is not. I mean, John McCarthy will tell you that, and he's been talking a lot about the scoring on Twitter, so I encourage you to find that if you're so interested as well. But, you know, sometimes when a fighter appears to be moving away from the action, even though a lot of fans know exactly what he's trying to do, you know, the crowd can get into it and start to boo, and maybe that can compromise judges. But as far as I'm concerned, you know, Nate Diaz has got to capitalize on that opening. When McGregor's body language is such that he's a little bit of a defeated fighter or he's catching a blow, Nate Diaz has to close and pressure, and in those situations, he didn't.
Right, and if a fighter is truly running away, if he's hurt or whatever, why didn't Nate go and cut off the cage and just go right at him?
Right.
He didn't because he was tired as well. He was eating shots as well. And Conor somehow found that extra gear in round four. I mean, you know, the way that fight was happening in the third round, the way it ended, I agree with you, John. I said the fight is over. There's no way Connor can go 25 minutes at this point. There's no way. The way that round ended and the way Nate was finishing so strong, I said he might be finished here in round four. But Connor found that extra gear. He threw a left kick to Nate's rib, and that changed the round. You see Nate kind of hunch over, and it's interesting that not a lot of people are talking about it, but you see Nate get hurt by it. He kind of hunches over, and Connor just took over. He got more confidence as the round went on and ended up winning that round pretty clearly in my eyes. And, yeah, like you said, I had it 1-2-4 and 3-5 I had for Diaz. But
Diaz does amazing. An amazing job, sorry to cut you off, of just disguising the extent to which he's hurt.
Yes.
And the fact that Connor was able to seize the beginning of that fourth round really won him the fight. You know, statistically, McGregor was the busiest in round four of any round of the fight, and it was certainly the most crucial. And, you know, the Diaz performance, I thought, really was quite good. I mean, certainly one of the bigger hearts you have in MMA. If he's not the toughest guy on the roster, he's certainly in that conversation. But, you know, for me, just got hit too much in this fight.
Yeah.
And I think Connor's ability to diversify and not discriminate, going body and the leg kicks and going up top, I thought the body shots, as you mentioned, took their toll. The leg kicks certainly did. And it's one thing to know what type of adjustments you need to make, especially when you're not necessarily a leg kicker like Conor McGregor. You know, he didn't come in with the reputation of being a big leg kicker. To make the adjustments, to manage your cardio, but then to execute, you know, and I think his execution to me was near perfect. I mean, certainly got hit, certainly almost lost, I guess, there in round three. But to beat the bigger man and to exact the revenge, I thought he, over 25 minutes, handled himself to near perfection.
How many 145-pounders in today's modern UFC, at 145 pounds, how many 145-pounders can go up to 170 and win any fight in that weight class? How many?
Yeah, well,
now, how many can go up and beat Nate Diaz for 25 minutes? There's no one who could do it. And, you know, say what you want about Connor. You can hate on him all day. But that last fight is the defining moment of his career and showed what kind of heart he has. And even if he lost that fight to Nate Diaz, to go 25 minutes with that savage called Nate Diaz,
yeah,
was unreal for me. And I think just made his career. And you're going to see it probably propel him to even greater heights. It was unbelievable.
I mean, I agree. I've always contended that the McGregor brand and his drawing power could withstand losses and even a second one here, I think, to Nate Diaz. But to get this win, you're right, and to get it the way he got it, with the ebb and flow and everything else, just remarkable. And I think arguably the biggest win of Connor's career.
Yes.
And he joins Kenny Florian as the only two men in UFC history. Turn your radios up, by the way, for this. Only two fighters in UFC history to win a UFC fight at 45 and 70. Kenny Florian. We like that. I don't think TJ's mic is working today, but I know as a perennial and perpetual Florian hater, he's got to be like, wow, that's something.
He picked against me at 170. Wrong move, TJ.
So for Conor McGregor, highest purse in UFC history at $3 million, and of all the reasons to be happy, Nate Diaz walks with $2 million, and deservedly so, 30th pro fight or so, and not surprisingly, he wants another fight with Conor McGregor, and he wants another payday. Certainly smart of him when he says he won't fight anyone else. Love seeing him realize a $2 million payday. Maybe he makes three or four for the trilogy fight if it happens. In terms of what happens next, Kenny, at least for Conor McGregor, I guess one of the big questions is, what is the difference in terms of the payday for Conor McGregor if he fights Nate Diaz or if he fights for the UFC lightweight championship against Eddie Alvarez? Because he was as clear as day on the microphone with Joe Rogan after the fact that he's not chasing the UFC lightweight title right now. He wants to do the trilogy fight and fight Diaz down a division at 155.
Yeah, you know, it's all going to come down to dollars and cents. I don't even think he's motivated by championship belts at this point. He wants the money fight. He wants the money fight. So I know George St. Pierre is out there, and I know Connor said something to the effect that he would not fight at 170 again or probably won't fight at 170 again. But I know that that payday is probably very attractive to him. If he can get maybe some kind of catch weight out of GSP, maybe at 160 or 165, who knows. But I think Alvarez would probably bring in a little bit more money than Aldo. That's my opinion. I think his move is to go Alvarez. If he can get by Alvarez, I think he fights Diaz again at 155. If he gets by Diaz, then he fights probably Cerrone. And those are all big fights at 155 pounds. I don't know if Conor wants to mess around at 170 anymore. I mean, you know, to finish a guy like Nate Diaz or finish anyone at 170 is going to be difficult for him. He's just not a natural 170-pounder. So it was impressive how he did it. You can't talk about his heart anymore. You ain't going to say Newton. You ain't going to say Newton.
Newton. I just feel like McGregor was motivated by being a two-division champion simultaneously right. or otherwise, and maybe he was just motivated by the dollars that would come by being a two-division champion when he pushed for that Dos Anjos fight and ultimately got it, which should have happened earlier this year back in March. But it will be interesting to see what they do, because certainly the fans and I think a lot of the casual MMA fans want to see this trilogy fight, and they want to see it here to close out 2016 and have sort of this be the year of McGregor and Diaz. They fight three times, and then they can go chasing title belts from there. You know, I think Nate Diaz certainly is a relevant guy at 155 if he had any sort of championship aspiration, but it seems to be about the money fight. And,
right.
and you know, I think you got to respect McGregor, because even though he would have some advantages down at 155 pounds, and even though he certainly has opened up as the favorite for any presumed trilogy fight, to your point, this is still a tough style matchup for him fighting Nate Diaz, and now he's welcoming it and wanting it a third time. So I think more props to him there.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And you know, I think that, yeah, the belt is motivating for him, but at the end of the day, you know, Conor knows that it's going to be about the money fights. Even at 145, you know, they talked about, oh, maybe stripping him at 145. He said, I don't care. Give it to the guy. And it's they're in a tough situation, because what are they going to do? Give it to the guy, to Jose Aldo, who he beat in 13 seconds. It's rough, man. I mean, Conor really is in the pilot's chair right now. He really is.
And Eddie Alvarez is in the pilot's chair as well. We're going to talk to him here in a few minutes. I just think it's interesting, because Conor's show money was $3 million for this fight. Nate Diaz's was $2 million. So if Conor now fights for the UFC lightweight championship on pay-per-view, whether it's Madison Square Garden or otherwise, again, I get back to the original question. Is the payoff fighting Alvarez that much of a drop-off for fighting Nate Diaz? I really don't know. You know, I'm not an insider when it comes to that stuff, but I think that's certainly a big part of the equation, the most crucial. And, you know, the Diaz performance I thought really was quite good. I mean, certainly one of the bigger hearts you have in MMA. If he's not the toughest guy on the roster, he's certainly in that conversation. But, you know, for me, just got hit too much in this fight. Yeah. And I think Conor's ability to diversify and not discriminate, going body and the leg kicks and going up top, I thought the body shots, as you mentioned, took they're told the leg kick certainly did. And it's one thing to know what type of adjustments you need to make, especially when you're not necessarily a leg kicker like Conor McGregor. You know, he didn't come in with right. the reputation of being a big leg kicker, to make the adjustments, to manage your cardio, but then to execute, you know. And I think his execution to me was near perfect. I mean, certainly got hit, certainly almost lost, I guess, there in round three. But to beat the bigger man and to exact the revenge, I thought he, over 25 minutes, handled himself to near perfection.
How many 145-pounders in today's modern UFC, at 145 pounds, how many 145-pounders can go up to 170 and win any fight in that weight class? How many? Yeah, well, now, how many can go up and beat Nate Diaz for 25 minutes? There's no one who could do it. And you know, say what you want about Conor, you can hate on him all day, but that last fight is the defining moment of his career and showed what kind of heart he has. And even if he lost that fight to Nate Diaz, to go 25 minutes with that savage called Nate Diaz was unreal for me. And I think just made his career. And you're going to see it probably propel him to even greater heights. It was unbelievable.
I mean, I agree. I've always contended that the McGregor brand and his drawing power could withstand losses and even a second one here, I think, to Nate Diaz. But to get this win, you're right, and to get it the way he got it, with the ebb and flow and everything else, just remarkable. And I think arguably the biggest win of Conor's career. Yes. And he's turning his back a little bit as possible grounds for timidity, which it most certainly is not. I mean, John McCarthy will tell you that. And he's been talking a lot about the scoring on Twitter, so I encourage you to find that if you're so interested as well. But, you know, sometimes when a fighter appears to be moving away from the action, even though a lot of fans know exactly what he's trying to do, you know, the crowd can get into it and start to boo, and maybe that can compromise judges. But as far as I'm concerned, you know, Nate Diaz has got to capitalize on that opening. When McGregor's body language is such that he's a little bit of a defeated fighter or he's catching a blow, Nate Diaz has to close and pressure, and in those situations, he didn't.
Right, and if a fighter is truly running away, if he's hurt or whatever, why didn't Nate go and cut off the cage and just go right at him?
Right.
He didn't because he was tired as well. He was eating shots as well. And Conor somehow found that extra gear in round four. I mean, you know, the way that fight was happening in the third round, the way it ended, I agree with you, John. I said the fight is over. There's no way Conor can go 25 minutes at this point. There's no way. The way that round ended and the way Nate was finishing so strong, I said he might be finished here in round four. But Conor found that extra gear. He threw a left kick to Nate's rib, and that changed the round. You see Nate kind of hunch over, and it's interesting that not a lot of people are talking about it, but you see Nate get hurt by it. He kind of hunches over, and Conor just took over. He got more confidence as the round went on and ended up winning that round pretty clearly in my eyes. And, yeah, like you said, I had it 1-2-4 and 3-5 I had for Diaz. But
Diaz does amazing. An amazing, amazing job, sorry to cut you off, of just disguising the extent to which he's hurt.
Yes.
And the fact that Conor was able to seize the beginning of that fourth round really won him the fight. You know, statistically, McGregor was the busiest in round four of any round of the fight, and it was certainly... Well, you were hard-pressed to find a UFC fighter, past or present, who was picking Conor McGregor to beat Nathan Diaz on Saturday night. It seemed like the pre-fight was owned by Diaz, at least according to a lot of people. You saw a very emotional Conor McGregor in the days leading up to the fight, spilled over at the press conference, at the weigh-in. Even a guy like Brian Stann was waffling on it and eventually sided with Nate Diaz. Kenny Florian, one of the few guys who stuck with Conor McGregor from the beginning, and you had to like what you saw, man. Just a masterful performance, the adjustments, the execution, the heart, and everything else, and I think you and I are in agreement that he deserved to win the fight, and we'll start there.
He absolutely did, man. And you know what? Conor didn't just have to deal with Nate Diaz. He was fighting a few things here. Obviously, fighting the pressure of having to come off the most devastating loss of his career, the most high-profile loss of his career. There was a lot of pressure on him, you know, coming off this whole UFC 200 debacle. Fighting a man at 170 pounds, Nate Diaz probably was... you know, at least 185 pounds on fight night. I mean, there was just so much that he had to tackle here, and he responded extremely well. His ability to slip punches and return with that left hand, it's one of the most potent weapons in the game right now. Just looked masterful. And how many different strikes he threw with his upper body. I mean, the punches to the body, the punches to the head, slipping left and landing in the left, slipping right and landing with the left hand, landing that right hook repeatedly. I mean, the guy was on fire. It was really a masterful performance. Nate Diaz is as tough as they fucking come, okay?
Toughest fighter on the roster. It's
unbelievable. I mean, the damage that he took, he couldn't see in a couple rounds, and he continues to press forward, continues to look for a way to win. I mean, it was just such an insane fight. Now, for anyone who had it for Nate Diaz, you're crazy. I mean, that's just as simple as that. Round two, some people had round two for Diaz. How do they have – in what bizarro world do you have a guy who wins a round, who gets knocked down twice in the fight and loses 3 minutes and 30 seconds of the round and didn't knock down the other guy once?
Right.
You can't score it for Diaz, unfortunately. I mean, I know you guys are hardcore fans, and that's a lot of it, John. I feel like heading into this fight, people hated Conor McGregor so much that they didn't want to hear about Conor winning. They thought Nate was going to win. Their minds were completely skewed over to Nate Diaz's side. And is Nate Diaz a fantastic fighter? Absolutely. Is he a tough style matchup for Conor McGregor? Absolutely. But Conor did win that fight. You know, I was talking to TJ over here earlier about round three. He thought it should have been a 10-8 round for Nate. I didn't see it as a 10-8 round. I thought it was close enough throughout. At the end, I thought Nate finished extremely strong, and Conor was absolutely hurt in that fight. But in that round, I didn't think it was a 10-8, like one of the judges called it.
Right.
You know, it had it a draw, but just a fantastic fight. And TJ tweeted something earlier that there was no loser, and I absolutely agree with that as well.
And, you know, I'm okay with Judges being liberal with a 10-8 there in round three relative to some other rounds, but I had it the way you did, rounds 1, 2, and 4 for Conor McGregor. And the fourth round, I think, is going to be the story of this fight and what people are talking about months from now. Some people are suggesting this is the single best round that Conor McGregor has ever fought in the UFC, and to do it on the heels of what happened in round three is just sort of superhuman, you know, for someone like me sitting home on my couch. A lot of the criticism coming from people who believe that Nate Diaz won this fight was about Conor McGregor sort of resetting, walking away, borderline. He joins Kenny Florian as the only two men in UFC history. Turn your radios up, by the way, for this. Only two fighters in UFC history to win a UFC fight at 45 and 70. Kenny Florian. We like that. I don't think TJ's mic is working today, but I know as a perennial and perpetual Florian hater, he's got to be like, wow, that's something.
He picked against me at 170. Wrong move, TJ.
For Conor McGregor, highest purse in UFC history at $3 million, and of all the reasons to be happy, Nate Diaz walks with $2 million, and deservedly so, 30th pro fight or so, and not surprisingly, he wants another fight with Conor McGregor, and he wants another payday. Certainly smart of him when he says he won't fight anyone else. Love seeing him realize a $2 million payday. Maybe he makes 3 or 4 for the trilogy fight if it happens. In terms of what happens next, Kenny, at least for Conor McGregor, I guess one of the big questions is, what is the difference in terms of the payday for Conor McGregor if he fights Nate Diaz or if he fights for the UFC lightweight championship against Eddie Alvarez? Because he was as clear as day on the microphone with Joe Rogan after the fact that he's not chasing the UFC lightweight title right now. He wants to do the trilogy fight and fight Diaz down a division at 155.
Yeah, you know, it's all going to come down to dollars and cents. I don't even think he's motivated by championship belts at this point. He wants the money fight. He wants the money fight. So I know George St. Pierre is out there, and I know Conor said something to the effect that he would not fight at 170 again or probably won't fight at 170 again. But I know that that payday is probably very attractive to him.
Right.
If he can get maybe some kind of catch weight out of GSP, maybe at 160, 165, who knows. But I think Alvarez would probably bring in a little bit more money than Aldo. That's my opinion. I think his move is to go Alvarez. If he can get by Alvarez, I think he fights Diaz again at 150.